you see our hardworking members from ABF, DHL, YRC, which is now Yellow, whatever name they come under, and our UPS guys, as you all know, driving around Chicago, delivering your packages. Today, we're proud to say we're going to deliver Senator Bernie Sanders and some of the most badass labor activists this country has ever seen. We are all used to politicians telling us what we want to hear, that corporate greed has to be reined in, and that the middle class has to be rebuilt. We're used to seeing them on the TV and in the newspapers saying how they're going to change. The difference with Bernie and the others up here is that I hear them as they are marching, standing next to us as we are on the streets fighting for better pay, safer jobs, the respect and dignity that we deserve, and most of all, fighting against corporate greed. Here at Teamster City, 705, we are all too familiar with fighting against corporate greed. You see, the wall back here says it all. Fighting for the future. That's what we do on a daily basis, and we win. As I started my fight for my coworkers back when I was 70 pounds lighter and back in 1989, and it was a while ago, you know, we were fighting about harassment. You know, my package car colleagues were out there trying to do a job. Have you ever seen a UPS guy walk? Don't you ever see them running all the time, hustling? Well, can you believe it that UPS believes they're not working fast enough, hard enough, and quick enough? That ain't right. That ain't right. Excessive hours. Our drivers, men and women, can't participate in parent-teachers conferences. They can't see their kids play baseball, all because they're starting at 7 o'clock in the morning, going home at 9 o'clock at night. You see them out there. You see them delivering. All because of bottom dollar, the bottom line, the end of the numbers that the corporate America looks at. Once my brothers and sisters made me realize that we could take on corporate greed and win, I never looked back. Never looked back. During the pandemic, we all went through that pandemic. We all saw just how ugly corporate greed can get, right? We all seen the tragedy, yet corporate America seen the opportunity. Union members did everything from taking care of the sick, delivering your packages, checking you out at the grocery stores. What did corporations do in return besides sit home and be safe while we put our lives at risk to make that bottom dollar count for them? All they did was buy a goddamn billboard and call us heroes. And then they told us, shut up, get back to work, do more. Well, I'm here to tell you today that Teamsters Local 705 is never going to shut up. And UPS better be ready for us during our next contract fight. Because we are more militant, more organized, more pissed off than ever before. And it's just not the Teamsters. Today, you're going to hear from some of the most badass people in the labor movement, rideshare, drivers, Starbucks workers, teachers, flight attendants, the people that make this country run. The people that are going to, that are taking on corporate greed head on and winning. I'm proud to introduce one of those fighters as your next speaker. Please give a well welcome to JC Muhammad.
Thank you, thank you. I'm very delighted to be here. Chances are some of you, probably most of you, got here courtesy of an Uber or Lyft, right? That driver that got you here evidently got you here safely and on time, right? And if they didn't get you here exactly on time for the rally, well, at least they got you here in time for my remarks, so I really appreciate that. But no, seriously, though, these two companies, Uber and Lyft, have very quietly gotten to a point where they control and dominate about 40% of the transportation network here in this city, right? And they make up a huge part of what's called the new gig economy. Coming out of 2021, Uber actually increased their revenue 87%, $5.4 billion. Lyft wasn't too far behind, $3.2 billion. Meanwhile, the drivers that were called essential workers during the pandemic, most of them haven't been able to climb out of debt since the pandemic. In fact, most of them haven't even been able to find a ladder to a livable wage. Some of them haven't been able to climb out of poverty. I'm JC Muhammad. I'm actually a gig worker, okay? I represent a group called the Chicago Gig Alliance. Now, the Gig Alliance is a project of the People's Lobby, group that's been around for a long time. Yeah, he knows about them. They fight for economic justice, gender justice, racial justice, right? When they invited us to come here, we immediately said, yeah, we got to be here. We have got to be here. Why? Because we want to put the city of Chicago on notice that you cannot run roughshod over Chicago residents, adults, heads of household, struggling to make ends meet, right? And working to put bread on the table. These people are the essential backbone of these huge mega companies. And that's right, that's right. Yeah, we gotta let her know, right? We gotta let her know, right? While the city's been asleep at the switch, gig workers have been transporting people all around the city, all around the county, right? Delivering packages and food at any time of day and night, willing to go anywhere at any time, sometime in very dangerous and unsafe places, and doing so with their own vehicles, with their own equipment. And the wages are getting lower and lower. I don't need to tell you about the gas prices, right? Come on now. Gas prices are skyrocketing through the roof. And get this, gig workers like myself can be deactivated and terminated without cause and without recourse. Exactly. So what we have proposed is what's called a Chicago rideshare living wage and safety ordinance. Right now, that ordinance has garnered the support of 15 aldermen. We're putting, not enough, right? Because we got to push it over the top, right? We're putting that ordinance before every single alderman and asking, where do they stand? What kind of Chicago do you want to see for this next, 100 years? Do you want to see an economy that's a new gig economy that offers prosperity and opportunity to Chicago residents? Or do you want to see a new low-income plantation. Right? We know what we want to see. We're asking them, what do they want to see? So we want them to take a stand on this ordinance and tell us where they stand. Because quite frankly, it's the gig workers that are taking their children to school and getting them there safely, taking them to work and getting them there safely, right? While the gig workers are also getting the shaft. So are they going to stand up for their constituents, or are they going to punk out to the big mega companies? I tell you a quick story. This happened to me just yesterday, and I'm a Lyft and Uber driver. I'm on State Street and Jefferson. I'm trying to get a ride a mile and a half to Harrison and Jefferson. Lyft wants to charge $48. Uber wants to charge $54 to go a mile and a half. Now, how much of that do you think the driver's getting? Right? There you go. So, to wrap this up, next week, 1 week from today, we're actually holding a protest in front of the Uber Hub. That's right. 10:30 a.m., June 23rd, we're in front of the Uber Hub, and we are making all these grievances known, and we're also outlining or laying out the solutions to the problem, because we have solutions. We're not just here to gripe. We want to show them how they can make this system better for everyone, right? So next week, if you can make it, we would like to have some of you guys out so we can lay out what we think needs to happen at our press conference, protest, and rally. And I thank you for your time. I love to be here. The Chicago gig workers stand with the Teamsters, stand with Bernie Sanders, stand with Chuy Garcia. We love you guys. You have been the tip of the spear in the fight for economic justice and workers' rights. Thank you for my time. All right.
Please welcome from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, Adjunct Professor Christy McGuire.
What's up, Bernie Rally? My name is Christy McGuire, and I'm an adjunct professor at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. And I'm here today to remind you that greed is not limited to corporations. SAIC prides itself as America's leading art school, where the cost of undergraduate tuition exceeds $50,000 a year. Our president earns over $700,000 annually. Our school and our museum share an endowment worth $1 billion. It's clear that the issue isn't money. The issue is predictable, basic bitch decisions made in support of the market and not our students, staff, and faculty. Non-tenure track lecturers and adjuncts like yours truly make up more than 75% of our faculty. They call us part-time, though many of us teach more than our full-time colleagues. The fact remains, we are contingent frontline workers. We are also educators, mentors, advisors, program directors, and working artists. We work at SAIC because we believe in the value of arts education, and we know that our institution's world-class reputation is built on our labor. During the pandemic, we saw our contracts gutted. We have no job security, no avenues for promotion, and no guarantee of classes from one term to the next. This week, we received a friendly email from our school president who celebrated our much improved financial situation and listed some questionable budgetary highlights, like $700,000 worth of new carpeting and increased healthcare costs. The truth is, the majority of us have no access to benefits at all, including health insurance, despite the fact that we were coerced into teaching in person during a global pandemic. Our president said, we might receive a 2% pay increase this year if we hit an enrollment target that we have no control over, and friendly reminder that just the cost of living increase alone this next annual year is more than 8%. So I don't know if we're gonna get that 2%, but I can tell you one thing we're gonna get. We're gonna get a union. More than 600 of us are forming our union with Art Institute of Chicago Workers United, what we call ACWU, part of AFSCME, building on the incredible work of our staff colleagues at the school and the museum. I am so honored to have two of them with me on the stage today. Please meet Katie Rutledge and Maya Brown. Applause on the mic. They overcame an anti-union campaign by our bosses that included interference to win by a landslide. They elected their bargaining team, and they are literally taking a seat at the table for their first contract as we speak to secure the long overdue structural changes they fought so hard to win. We're gonna do the same thing. We don't want our students to become another generation of indentured servants crushed by the massive debt that we are. We don't want our lecturers cut off from institutional benefits like healthcare. What we really don't want are more vapid emails that pat our administrators on the back for a job well done. As the most diverse group of educators at SAIC, we want to stand with our students to combat and dismantle the school's systemic failures at social and racial justice, equity, access, and investment in the next generation of teaching artists. By forming our union, we are demanding that the school and the museum do better because they can't do any worse. Yeah. We are not alone. We know others are watching and following our lead. Thousands of our peers nationwide, in Minneapolis, in LA, in Philly, are forming their own unions under the banner of Cultural Workers United. In joining them, we are not only lifting up our colleagues, but we are insisting that all labor has value, including cultural workers, arts workers, and teaching artists. Comrades, like Senator Sanders, I am asking you once again to believe that sustainable change comes from the bottom up and not the top down. Yeah. Nothing is more powerful than the solidarity, the collectivity, and the care that I have experienced organizing alongside my colleagues. We know our working conditions are our students' learning conditions. We know our present is their future. And we understand there is no real equity to be had without power sharing. We are stronger together. Because our union isn't some arcane fiction or something outside of us. The union is us. Oh, and we're gonna win. Thank you.
Okay, so AIC Woo, we have a chant. Who are you?
AIC Woo!
Say it with us. Who are you?
Now, please welcome from Starbucks Workers United, Finn Doris.
Hey, everybody, how's it going? My name is Finn, they, them pronouns. I am a barista at the largest unionized Chicago store. thank you. I'm really honored to be one voice amongst hundreds and thousands of other labor workers who are looking to expand their rights and protect the rights that are promised to us and should be forever promised to us. Thank you, I'm short. since filing to unionize, we've faced pressure and punishment from upper management. We've had hour cuts that will result in lost benefits for partners the next quarter. There are people who went from having free Starbucks therapy one week to finding out their hours had been cut and they can't see their therapist the next week. Bad job, everybody, yeah. Despite these obstacles and challenges, my store banded together and we have an incredible community and incredible camaraderie, and frankly, May 25th, that's how we did it and won 20-3. I am absolutely endlessly grateful and inspired by the people I work with, by the other partners I have the privilege to connect with over Zoom, new stores that are filing, stores that are getting interested in filing. I'm in Zoom meetings weekly just being like, yeah, you guys can do it. Here's what we did. Like, here are some hot tips for you guys. And it's incredible the impact that we've had. And I'm so happy and I'm so proud of everybody. Thanks. I also have the great privilege of being the first to speak on the new Starbucks Workers United pledge that they are rolling out this weekend. There have been a lot of pledges and promises in different smaller communities that only really affect that community, but Starbucks Workers United is putting out a nationwide pledge, and we're hoping by the end of the Union Votes Conference this weekend to get 10,000 signatures. I do not have the graphic on me, but if you go to any of our social medias, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, anything, TikTok also, please get on the TikTok. There is a link on all of our social medias. And thank you, I'm so thankful. Hold on, one more time. A revolution takes a community of people working to change, and every voice matters. And I thank you for allowing me to be that voice this evening.
And now, please welcome CTU President-elect, Stacey Davis-Gates.
So, hello, Chicago. That's more like it. I pay him. No, he actually pays me. That's Oscar, one of the most enthusiastic, committed organizers, rank and file organizers in our union, and he has never not been there for us. So shout out to Oscar. Can y'all give him a round of applause? So you've been waiting a while, and you want me to hurry up. You all want me to hurry up. So what I want to do first is say welcome to Chicago for those of you who are here for Labor Notes. Welcome. Welcome to the city that holds the labor movement down. Welcome to the birthplace of my forever president, Karen Lewis. and welcome to the city that gives the Chicago Teachers Union a lot of love and support. Isn't it something to be in this crowd today? Isn't it something to feel the power of the worker? And isn't it something to be at Teamsters, where their new leadership said they are going to shake up this country? Isn't it something to have a leader of Teamsters that is four generations deep and bleeds this union? Give it up for O'Brien. President O'Brien, the labor movement in Chicago, and in particular, the Chicago Teachers Union, has a lot of hope for the type of coalition that we can build across industry. But I want to talk about America. An America that saw over a million people die in a pandemic that some of us cannot even acknowledge. An America where those people went to work every day. An America where the people who went to work didn't have health care. We are in a country that is full of contradictions, you all. Full of contradictions. We have teachers, educators, and students dying in school buildings, and we have elected officials saying that the way forward is to arm teachers, but not to fund schools. The contradiction is that we have workers at the Howard Brown Health Center who are organizing, not just because they're workers, but because their clients need organized workers to advocate for their humanity. I keep thinking of what I can say to inspire. And what I keep thinking of is this quote from Dr. King, who said that power is purpose achieved. Power is purpose achieved. Labor, what is our purpose? Labor, what is our purpose? Because our purpose has to connect to our needs. It has to connect to our humanity. So let me tell you what I think our purpose is in labor. I think our purpose in labor is to protect, defend, wrap our arms around the worker. I think our purpose is to support the burgeoning, strong movement happening in Starbucks and Amazon of workers. Workers who ran this country. You still got coffee. You didn't miss a package, but they missed their families. They miss health care. They miss dignity. So how do we support workers? If our purpose is to support our workers, what is our purpose, labor? Is it to act like we are in America that doesn't yet recognize the humanity of my 13-year-old black son? I make it personal. If it's up here, we don't feel it. We live in a country that says that black lives matter, but every time we see B-roll. So what is our purpose, labor? Are we human only from 9 to 5? Or does it matter what my community feels like when I drive home at 5:30. What is our purpose, labor? I'm a woman, and I have 3 beautiful children. And when I work, child care cannot absorb all of that because I still got a mortgage, I still got an electric bill, and I still got a gas bill. I live in Chicago. So is our purpose in labor to fight for women's reproductive rights? Is our purpose in labor to fight for universal child care? What is our purpose, labor? Is our purpose to make housing affordable because you know everybody ain't getting paid $15 yet? What is our purpose, labor? Is our purpose to fight for the justice and equity and dignity of the worker from 9 to 9? Or is it 24/7, 365, and every facet of our lives? What is our purpose, labor? Let me say this. The Chicago Teachers Union, the women and the men who pay those union dues were forced to create purpose outside of the work because they have children coming into their classrooms that live in a city that tolerates segregation, that tolerates the brutality of black and brown youth. So what we did, what we said we needed in this moment was a union that saw the humanity, not just of the workers, but of the people that we serve. So when I think about the workers at Howard Brown, I know that they have purpose because they say that the LGBTQIA plus community deserves purpose, dignity, and their power. So they are not just organizing because they need a better wage. They are organizing because their community needs protection, visibility, and they are organizing because the power of the union is transformative. They are organizing because they understand that the work that they do has purpose. Labor, I need you to see purpose at the negotiating table that says common good. I need you to see purpose in the community that says racial equity. I need you to see purpose in the work floor when the women come in and say, I got your back. Power is purpose achieved. What are we willing to sacrifice to achieve our power? Will we open our negotiating table for people who ain't been there before? Will we open our leadership to women who may need a little more support? Will we open the work that we do to the communities that we're anchored in? Purpose. Our purpose is to transform this country. Our purpose is to anchor it in common good. Our purpose is to see the humanity and the dignity and work and all of the people who do it. Our purpose is to say that you don't have to dream to become American, that we are going to make it work for you to become American because you earned it, because you deserve it, because you crossed the border, because you needed it. Thank you, workers at Starbucks. Thank you, workers at Amazon, because you are democratizing labor. You are saying it is open for all. You are naming justice. You are naming equity, and you are doing it from the bottom to the top. Power is purpose achieved. Labor. What is our purpose? Thank you, Chicago.
Please welcome AFA CWA Delta Flight Attendant Johnny Lane.
I'm sorry, I have to take a moment. I'm so overwhelmed looking at everyone out here. It's truly amazing. I just want to let you all know, my name's Johnny. I'm a Delta flight attendant, and I work for the only non-union carrier in this country. But it means a lot to me to be here today with all of my union brothers and sisters here. That we are finally able to join you all in solidarity. And I am also proud to be here with my president, my friend, and my mentor, and the most badass labor leader in the country here today, Sara Nelson. Let me tell you something, it's amazing. And since I'm among friends here today, I got a story to tell y'all about why I'm here and why I'm organizing. This happened years ago, but it's a story about when my car was stolen. Now, my car being stolen isn't the important part of the story. It's what my employer did when I told them my car was stolen. So, like I said, I've been a flight attendant for over 14 years, and a common line that they tell us is that you don't need a union. You don't need a contract. I know. Our work rules, you're gonna love this. Our work rules have gray areas. Because you know what? We can help you. We can understand you. Our hands won't be tied when you have problems. So those gray areas will benefit you. Okay? Let me finish. I'm getting to the good part, so let me finish. So the day after my car was stolen, I was supposed to attend an event, a company-wide event, that was voluntary. I signed up for it. I wanted to go. And then my car was stolen. So I called and advised them. I said, hey, you know what? I'm not going to be able to make it. My car was stolen. I'm dealing with insurance. I'm filing police reports. I'm so preoccupied. I don't even know how I would get there in the first place. Just won't be able to go. So this is what they told me. Well, if you had called 2 weeks in advance, 2 weeks in advance, it wouldn't go on your record. But since you're calling the day before, we apologize, but it's gonna be a mark on your attendance record. Because everyone plans to get their car stolen before going to a voluntary event, right? Okay. So the reality is, without a contract, those rules might be gray, but when it benefits Delta, they're black and white. And as a matter of fact, when it benefits them, they could be whatever color they want them to be. So we're gonna fast forward to November 2019, when we launched our official AFA campaign to organize. Right. Yeah, I'm going to set the scene. This was November 2019. I was so hopeful. I was ready, excited. We were going to do this. This was our year. Then you all know what happened. The pandemic hit. Things changed for the airlines. So many of my coworkers stopped flying or they quit entirely. It was so hard to organize. People wouldn't even want to talk about the union. They were afraid to even say the word at work. And I was so lonely, so defeated and hopeless. And I know you all have seen the news. Some of the stories seem sensationalized, but my colleagues here, we have some Delta flight attendants here, they can tell you. Yes, they're right there, and they could tell you that those stories were real. People were yelling in our faces, threatening to punch us and fight us. That's right, scumbags. And working conditions deteriorated, not just for my airline, but all over the industry. And continuously, Delta showed us why we needed a union and why we needed a real voice in the workplace. But I do have good news. The tide is shifting. I just worked recently, and three brand new flight attendants, their first trip at Delta. I had a conversation with them, and they signed a card to show support for the union. And let me tell you what that means. That means for us, organizing under the Railway Labor Act, more than 50% of us have to show support for the union. That means over 12,000 flight attendants at Delta Airlines have to show support for the union, and they need to sign a card within 1 year to trigger a vote. So we know it's gonna take hard work, but we know we can win. And so not too long ago, I remember talking to my mom about when I was just getting involved with organizing in our campaign. And she's a retired teacher of over 35 years. Shout out to teachers. She's a rabble rouser and a union organizer. After she organized the teachers at her school, she organized the cafeteria workers and the janitors. My mom's a badass woman too. And so when I went to my mom, I said, Mom, I don't know if I can do this. I don't know if I can get involved. I'm so afraid of what might happen. And my mom said, Johnny, why would you be afraid? There's strength in numbers. And so I want to be a part of a Delta Flight Attendants Union that is 22,000 flight attendants strong. And we're going to be a part of AFA, Association of Flight Attendants, that's 75,000 flight attendants strong. And then we're going to be a part of the movement with all of you that is growing, and it's million strong. And we're going to stay with it till it's 100 million strong, till we organize everyone who wants a union. And I know y'all are thinking, Johnny, that sounds like a lot. That sounds like hard work. It's gonna take a long time. But I want you to all take a moment and look around. Look at all the people here today. And remember what my mom told me, that you are not alone, that you don't have to be afraid anymore, because there is strength in numbers. And right now, I want y'all to keep your hands up, keep your energy up, because my friend, my mentor, I told you all about her before, my president, Sara Nelson, she's gonna come up here and tear up the stage. So y'all keep cheering, keep your energy up. Let's go.
Atta girl, atta girl.
Two weeks ago, Johnny said to me at a union meeting, if I ever get a chance to meet Bernie Sanders, I would lose it. Sara, can you possibly make that happen? Yes, Johnny, we can make that happen. It is great to be here tonight at Loco 705. Juan, thank you for your hospitality. And Asia, go win that election! So listen, we're all here together because we're all the working class. Right? We know which side we're on. Well, let me tell you something. As flight attendants, flying everywhere around the globe, we get to fly everywhere when some can only dream of crossing borders. We have more public contact than almost any other job, and we see it as our role to spread the message of unions around the world. And what you just heard from Johnny, and in support of the Delta flight attendants who are here tonight, and in support of the American flight attendants who are here tonight, and in support of the United flight attendants who are here tonight, we ask you, when you come up to the door, put your phone down, greet the flight attendants, let them know that you've got our backs. And if you're flying Delta, make sure that you talk to flight attendants about why you love your union. So as workers, solidarity doesn't have borders. Solidarity is not transactional. Solidarity is what we live in our hearts. And I want to point out, now this is going to be hard, because actually they're a little bit short, so I need your help. But I want to call out Mylene Cavallona and Ann Kruger, who are here from Bien Union in the Philippines. Let me just tell you about these fearless union organizers and workers in the call centers in the Philippines. In 2016, when 40,000 Verizon workers at CWA were on strike, Verizon rerouted calls to the Philippines call centers. And what did they do? They called up and said, "We're not going to be scabs. What can we do to help?" And they invited those strikers over to the Philippines. And we set up a picket outside their call center. And the Philippine military arrested all of them. And Verizon was embarrassed to hell. It was a turning point in the strike, and we won that strike. Now, Anne is an organizer. And in the Philippines in 2019, she was put in jail because she was red tagged by the government. They accused her. I wish you could see Anne right now, because honestly, if I wanted to feel comfort, if I wanted to feel at home, they're right over there. Right over there. Anne was even shorter than I am and is the most lovely person I've ever met, was thrown in jail because she was accused of being an armed communist terrorist. And so I want all of us here in the crowd tonight to pledge solidarity with Anne and with Mylene and let them know that we have their backs. If their government comes after them, they have to go through us. Now, international solidarity, that's right. Now, I'm a 25-year union flight attendant, but I should also say, well, I'm here with the Teamsters, I'm a Boston flight attendant, thank you very much. And Boston is where I learned what it means to be union. When I got there and my company failed to pay me, it was another flight attendant who tapped me on the back and offered me an $800 check and showed me first day on the job what solidarity looks like. And so I got involved. I got involved in our union because I met all these amazing people who I thought were incredible. And then we had bargaining and we negotiated a contract that I thought stunk. So I worked really hard to get it voted down, and when it didn't quite get voted down, I saw people throwing down union pins, and I thought, that looks real good. But then I thought of that flight attendant who stood there and offered me that solidarity and that hope when I didn't have any, because I couldn't even have a cent to get something to eat. And I said, we can be more. And what I learned is that I was a part of a union that was formed by women and fought through every discriminatory practice to try to turn this job into something that people leave when they're 32. That they leave when they get pregnant or get married. That they don't even get to have if they are black or indigenous or Latina. We fought for men to have the same rights on the job as women. You're welcome. And so I decided to get more involved. I decided to be a union agitator. I decided to use the democratic union that had been built for me off the backs of those brave women who fought for us to have a voice, not only in this country, but in the labor movement, and get involved and demand more. And so I became strike chair. And then September 11th happened. And Flight 175, you know the flight, because you've seen it from every angle, flying into the South Tower of the World Trade Center. After Flight 11 from American had flown in 17 minutes earlier. And that could have been me. But instead it was my friends and flying partners, Amy and Michael, Alicia, Al, Robert, Catherine, Marianne, Jesus, and Amy. And while we were grieving the loss of our friends, what we didn't know was that there were people who were out there looking at this as a chance to take everything from us, to take everything from an industry that was 80% organized, that had helped set the standards in the country for what it looks like to have a union, to have a good paycheck, to have time off, to be with your family, to have a pension, and to have secure health care. And they came for all of it. They came for all of it in that bankruptcy. And we fought them every single day. For 38 months, the longest bankruptcy in the airlines in U.S. history. They came for all of it. But because we fought them, and because we committed to fight for everything and hold on to everything that we possibly could, we had stronger footing to fight for what we really deserve. At the end of that bankruptcy, when $80 million would have saved our pensions, the court allowed termination of our pensions in one gavel, with the next one awarding $400 million to the top executives. So I've seen crisis, and I've seen capitalism take control. It is profits over people every single time. But because we fought, I want to give you some hope here. Because we fought, we saved retiree health care, and we doubled the amount they were willing to spend on a pension replacement plan. But we learned a thing or two. We learned a thing or two. No way in hell were we ever going to be taken advantage of ever again. And we also learned that one of the reasons they were able to do this was because they were able to tell people you should feel lucky to have a job. We're going to get back to that one. So when we saw the same sort of situation brewing with what was supposed to be a disagreement over whether or not our southern border security required a border wall, and this government allowed us to go into a government shutdown in December of 2018, we were watching very closely, because we know what happens when our federal sector sisters and brothers can't do their jobs. Our safety is on the line too. They are not a bunch of bureaucrats. They are our friends and neighbors who make sure that we get our Social Security checks, who make sure that our aircraft have a route so that Bernie Sanders can get here tonight, who make sure that we're safe when we go up there in the air. And they were going without a paycheck. Some of them summarily dismissed, the contract workers, a million of them, no notice, just out of work. 400,000 of them forced to come to work without pay. And we knew that our safety was on the line, and the people in our care, their safety was on the line. And when we go up in the air, we put our lives on the line, so you better bet we're not going up if it's not safe. And so we were talking with our federal sector sisters and brothers, and a lot of people were saying, oh, they should go strike. They should go end this. While in the White House, that was exactly what the person in the White House wanted them to do. That was exactly what the GOP wanted them to do. Because this had nothing to do with a border wall. This was about making government not work. This was about privatizing everything. And he didn't care if there was an accident. He didn't care if there was a terrorist attack, because that would have accrued more power to the executive office. So we saw what we were up against. There was going to be no negotiated solution between Speaker Pelosi and Leader McConnell. We were going to have to take control. And so we prepared to strike. And we talked to the rest of the labor movement about talking about a general strike. And so when those 10 air traffic controllers could no longer safely do their jobs, and the flights started to cancel in LaGuardia, we had a deal in a few hours after 35 days because the GOP could not allow us to get a taste of our power. I want you to take that in. They could not allow us to get a taste of our power. But we have the power. They have money and control right now, but we have the power, and it's high time we take control. Now, everything is on the line. Everything is on the line. 100 years ago, Mother Jones said, "The capitalists say there is no need of labor organizing except that they themselves are continually organizing and show their real beliefs." But she also said, you can solve the whole problem easily. If, for instance, every industry in America were to hold up, the capitalists would yield to any and all demands because the world could simply not go on. She was talking about a general strike. I want us to understand the strike is our tactic, solidarity is our power. And so we took that, and we took the power that we had generated. And when the airlines needed money in this crisis, we said, it's our demands first. We're going to get a workers first deal. We're going to get the money going to our paychecks. You can't fucking touch it. No cuts to pay. No austerity. But we're going to put caps on your pay that's in place until March of 2023. And a ban on stock buybacks that's in place until the end of September. Workers first. We drive this economy, and we know that they don't give a shit about us. We were treated as disposable during this pandemic, and we better understand what they think of us and what we have to do to change it. Now, I want to thank the brave strikers from the caucus of rank-and-file educators who built up their union at CTU, and Karen Lewis showing us that we can still strike in this country, and we can win. And I just want to know, how about that Mayor Stacey Davis Gates? Has a nice ring. CTU fought to make sure that there could be school nurses in the schools. Let's just think about that for a second. These children who were going to class and couldn't figure out how to learn, it was because they couldn't hear or there was something else going on. And that nurse identifying that for those parents who are working 2 and 3 jobs just to get by and not sure what they can do to help their child learn, the union made sure that they can learn. The union was there. The union is the answer. So we got a question. Which side are you on? The fight in front of us is not between men and women. It's not a fight between queer and straight, black and white, Democrats and Republicans. The real fight, the only fight that matters, is the fight between billions of people who get up and go to work for a few thousand dollars a month, and a few thousand billionaires who are stealing the value we produce, sucking off of every dollar they can and building rocket ships to jet off while leaving us on a burning planet. And they're coming for women. I was born in 1973, and for 49 years, women have been able to safely decide when to have children, who to have children with, and when to allow our bodies to belong to someone else. But they are coming for us again. Evil dictators start with belittling women. If you can lop off half of the population and make them less than human, the union busters have a big leg up, so we have to understand that this attack on women is an attack on all of us. They're coming for our LGBTQ siblings, for our Black, Brown, and AAPI and Indigenous siblings, trying to reinstate a Jim Crow world that was birthed in right to work. So when I say build your union, we have to wake up to our power, and we have to understand that that is the answer, unions. And so if you're done with poverty, build your union. If you believe healthcare is a human right, build your union. If you think a college degree shouldn't be a debt sentence, build your union. If you want to invest in educating kids instead of locking people up, build your union. If you want a green economy where workers and our planet thrive, build your union. If you want for yourself what you're willing to want for somebody else, even if they're different from you, build your union. And if you just want to tell the boss to kiss your ass, build your union. So I know somebody who's not afraid to tell the boss to kiss his ass. Someone who built a campaign right out of here at this union hall, the Teamsters Union Hall, and showed the entire country that workers and those of us in rank and file in the unions own our unions. We're going to hand it back to the rank and file, and that's where the power is. That's how we're going to move forward. I am super excited to be on this stage tonight with the amazing new president of the Teamsters, General President Sean O'Brien, and my brother from Boston.
Just for the record, I do not want to ever fight that woman right there. I'll fight with her, beside her, but never against her. Listen, thank you very much for allowing me this opportunity. I want to thank all the great speakers and the leaders who actually were up here with the courage and conviction to take on this white-collar crime syndicate known as corporate America. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I want to thank my good friend and my partner and one of the people that made it possible for us as Teamsters to take back this international union representing 1.2 million men and women working every single day in essential jobs. I want to recognize Juan Campos, my friend, international vice president, and also the principal officer of Local 705. And what do we say, 705 what? Thank you. I also want to thank, more importantly, everybody that's in this audience today. You know, we talk about our campaign, a little bit of history about myself. I'm a fourth generation Teamster out of the great Local 25 in Boston. I've been a 32-year member. I came out of the rigging industry. I worked rank and file since my 18th birthday. I took over Local 25, one of the most controversial but most vigilant local unions in the country at 33 years old. I also had the opportunity to run for international vice president in 2011 when I was elected the youngest vice president in the entire country. And I am proud to tell everybody every single day when they ask, what do you do for a living? I tell them I'm a Teamster truck driver and damn proud of it. You know, I had a great opportunity growing up. Because of four generations in the family, we were able to learn what it's all about to be a great Teamster, but more importantly, to be an advocate for people that didn't have a voice in the workplace. And I got that education around the dinner table. If we were at wakes, if we were at funerals, if we were at any function, the rhetoric always returned back to Teamsters Local 25. And the good thing about that is when I joined the local union, I had an advantage over people coming in the door. I had an advantage because I knew what it was to be a good union person. And the one thing we have to focus on right now, and I've learned this campaign in the last 3 years around the entire country, as if this next generation has a true thirst to organize, it's refreshing. It is absolutely refreshing. We have to embrace the new ideas, like the Starbucks workers, 150 strong locations. We have to educate, but we also have to embrace. We have to embrace new ideas and messing with the core values of what it truly means to be a trade unionist. We should never, ever, as leaders, rank and file members, ever run from our history, whether it's good or bad, because that history, good or bad, has brought us to where we are today and has positioned us to be the most powerful force, not only in the United States, but in the internal country. Working people will control this country and this world moving forward. Now, we've got a battle. We've got many battles with these white-collar crime syndicates known as corporate America, where they think that the new workers are afraid, where they think they're afraid to take on the boss, where they think our new workforce is vulnerable. That ends today, because I will commit to you on behalf of 1.2 million members strong in the strongest union in the entire world, the International Brother of Teamsters, you will not be alone in your fight, and we will fight till the death. The problem with corporate America, the Bezos of the world, the Schultz, the Musks of the world, they are all born on third base, and they think they hit a triple to get there. But their reign of terror is over. The one thing we have to focus on is having a vision. We have to eliminate the division. Far too long, this country was always recognized as being united. Unfortunately, we aren't anymore. We are divided. And who wins when we're divided? The bigwig corporate bosses like Bezos, Schultz, and Musk. And it's unfortunate because we have such a society where they prey on our infighting, they prey on our disagreements. That all needs to end tonight. We need to be one voice, one vision, one movement with one goal, is to make certain we take back the working class and reestablish a strong middle class where we can have health care, where we can have pensions, where we can retire and maintain our current lifestyle while we're working. My sister, are you ready for the fight? My brother, are you ready for the fight? Well, let's take it to the street. Now, they are not the only white-collar crime syndicate that's involved in demoralizing workers and taking advantage of workers. We also have elected officials that fail to recognize and fail to care about how important we are. I got the opportunity to travel all over this nation during the pandemic campaigning. And our pandemic for Teamsters, where we were considered essential workers, we were providing goods and services to this entire country, whether it was delivering groceries, delivering packages, picking up your rubbish, and anything else that we needed to survive. And we were all heroes at that point in time. And no one cared once the pandemic started to end. Corporate America just focused on the bottom line of their balance sheet and forgot about the people that made them the success. That's our rank and file. Those are our essential workers. And we are going to take back everything we want. We are not going to make demands. We're going to take from the rich. We're going to take. We're going to do what they do to us every single day. But the real disappointing thing in all this is the elected officials. The elected officials who fall in love with these spoiled billionaires who make campaign contributions and they sell their soul for a PAC. Instead of focusing on who really needs the help, who really needs the elected officials when we're in a pandemic, we're in a fight. They are the most corruptible people I've ever come across. The Lindsey Grahams, the Mitch McConnells. They have no problem watching corporate America's profits go up while our members and our working class wages go down. That ends today, that ends tonight, and we take the fight to the street once again. What is going to be germane to the success and survival of the labor movement is to organize. But before we organize, we need to mobilize. We need to strategize, organize, and then pulverize. These crooked politicians, these white-collar crime syndicates known as corporate America, have to understand the labor movement is not an individual sport. It is a team sport. And we can't afford to not engage. We will not have another opportunity like we have right now, where we have a little wager going on where, you know, my sister, Sara Nelson, you probably heard of her, said to me, looking in my eyes sincerely, said, do we have the ability to organize 1 million members over the next 10 years? I said, Sara, I'm only 29 years old. I know you're 28. We got the opportunity to do it with all of your help and all of your support. The one thing, as I mentioned, I come from a neighborhood in Boston, right? And my neighborhood was always filled with some type of conflict or controversy. And it was riddled with schoolyard bullies. And those schoolyard bullies would be out there every day looking at who was vulnerable, who they could attack, who they could basically extort. Well, corporate American politicians, not all, are no different than those schoolyard bullies that I had to face on my way home from school. And you had two choices. One, you could take the path of least resistance and find your way around your neighborhood and go back in your house, or you could do with anybody with any type of dignity, respect, courage, and conviction, knowing that the consequences may not be favorable, you could walk down that street, take on that schoolyard bully, gain the respect, and make certain that win, lose, or draw, that they knew we were coming back every single day until we win. It's no different. It's no different in the labor movement. We've got to go into work every single day, take on those schoolyard bullies known as management. We got to deal with those bullies in Washington, D.C., and make certain they know we may lose, regardless of consequences. We will be back every single day until we get what we want and get what we deserve. Now let's get back to the three amigos or the three stooges or whatever they're called. Bezos, Amazon, Tesla, Musk, Starbucks, Schultz, and the Lindsey Grahams of the world, and also the Mitch McConnells. They need to understand. They need to understand one thing. They need to understand that when you take on the Teamsters Union, you take on the flight attendants, you take on every single union in this country, but more importantly, you take on the rank and file members in each union that makes this country a success. You better put your helmets on and buckle your chin straps. It's a full contact sport. And Bezos, Schultz, and Musk, we're coming. We're coming hard. It's not going to be pretty. Listen, I have a philosophy I've lived my entire life, and I've taken it into my career. I'd rather ask for forgiveness than permission. So guess what, boys? We're coming for you. It's going to be hard. It's going to be painful. So ice up. Now, the one person who is vital for this fight to be successful in organizing, taking on corporate America, holding people accountable, because that word accountable doesn't exist in most cases in politics anymore. The one person who I had the opportunity to testify at a Senate budget hearing with that other corruptible politician, Lindsey Graham, where this person had the courage and conviction to call out the federal government and demand that they stop awarding billions upon billions of dollars to corporations that don't treat their workers properly, most notably Amazon. This person had the courage and conviction to stand up for working men and women in this country. It has inspired me, he's inspired the movement, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce our senator from Vermont, Bernie Sanders. Chicago!
You know, I have a feeling that tonight is the stuff that history is made out of. Tonight, right here in this great city, we're bringing people together to tell the ruling class of this country we are sick and tired of their greed. And we're not asking anymore. We are telling them enough is enough. I want to thank Sara Nelson and Sean O'Brien, two of the strongest progressive trade union leaders in America, for being here. The truth of the matter is that the current economic and political system is working great if you are a billionaire. It ain't working so great if you come from a family like mine, working class family, and families like yours. And I'm going to talk a little bit tonight about stuff you don't see in the corporate media and you don't hear too much in the halls of Congress. And that is that right now, at this moment, we have more income and wealth inequality in America than we have ever had as a nation. We have more concentration of ownership than we have ever had as a nation. And we have more corporate greed than we have ever had as a nation. But as Sean just indicated and Sara has made clear, it is not only a corrupt economic system, it is a corrupt political system as well. And I know I speak for the overwhelming majority of American people, not just Democrats, not just Republicans, not just independents, but all people who say we are sick and tired of billionaires buying elections and buying politicians. Let me say a little bit about what corporate greed is about. And again, this is the stuff you don't see on television, you're not gonna hear in Congress. This is what income, wealth, and inequality is about. Two people in America, Musk and Bezos, own more wealth than the bottom 130 million Americans. Top 1% owns more wealth than the bottom 92%. And here's something, you know, Sean, I caught most of his remarks, was talking about what went on here in the pandemic, the horrible time in our history where a million people have died, people getting sick every single day. And while people, working people, flight attendants, Teamsters, trade union workers went to work, put their lives on the line. 5,000 nurses have died from COVID during this pandemic. And we thank the nurses and we thank the doctors for protecting us. But while nurses and Teamsters and flight attendants and grocery store workers and postal workers went to work every day and died on the job, you got fewer than 1,000 billionaires increased their wealth by $2 trillion. Working people died, billionaires became much richer. We are not going to allow that to go on any longer. You want to hear about corporate greed? The CEOs of major corporations today make 350 times what the average worker in America makes. You know, our country faces a lot of addiction problems. We have a serious drug problem and an alcohol problem and a tobacco problem, but there's one problem we don't talk enough about, and that is the addiction of greed of the billionaire class. How much damn money do they need? And I'll tell you more about corporate greed. And as we drove in from the airport, I saw the price of gasoline here in Chicago. And this is what corporate greed is about, is that during this pandemic, during the breakdown of supply chains, during this terrible war in Ukraine, what the corporate world has done is used all of that to substantially raise prices in America. What we are looking at is a situation in terms of gas, and I want you to hear this. Today, my state, gas is a little over $5 a gallon. Here, it's a lot more than that. And you should know that during the first quarter of this year, the oil companies made over $93 billion in profit. There was a time when the, back I think in 2008, when a barrel of oil cost about $118, which is what it is today. At that point, gas was sold for $3.50 a gallon. So what these guys have done is take advantage of this moment and rip off working class people all over this country who have got to fill up their gas tank to get to work. And that is why we're going to fight for a windfall profits tax on those crooks. And the story is the same with food. It's not just gas, it's food. Right now, the price of beef has gone up 32%, chicken has gone up 20%, etc. Meanwhile, Tyson Foods saw a 140% increase in their profits last quarter. Same thing for prescription drugs. We pay the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. And yet, last year, three companies, big, large, major companies, increased their profits by 90%. Same thing with the insurance companies. So what we are seeing in America is the standard of living of working people going down while corporate profits are soaring and billionaires are becoming much richer. That's the bad news. Let me tell you what the good news is. You are the good news. The good news is that all across this country, where you saw very brave people on Staten Island at Amazon stand up and take on Jeff Bezos and win, and their brothers and sisters in Bessemer, Alabama came awfully close, and they're going to win next time around. 6 months ago, in Buffalo, New York, young people organized in two shops. Now it's 150 Starbucks shops that have been organized. And it's not only blue-collar workers. At MIT in Massachusetts, one of the great universities in America, they have been ripping off big-time adjunct professors. They voted overwhelmingly to go with the United Electrical Workers and form a union. In my own city of Burlington, Vermont, resident doctors, the young people who are doctors who are working in hospitals, they're working 70, 80 hours a week, they voted to organize a union. Now, in terms of union organizing, there are a couple of things that we have got to be clear about. We know what Bezos is doing at Amazon. We know what Schultz is doing at Starbucks. Their strategy is very clear. And that is they're going to stall and stall and stall. You vote for a union and they're going to have lawyers all over the place to make sure you don't get a first contract. And that is why, among other things, we have got to pass the PRO Act. Because we are sick and tired of companies intimidating and threatening their workers. Workers get fired because they're involved in union organizing. Companies threaten to leave the country when workers are attempting to organize. So we say to Bezos and to Schultz and to all of those guys, one way or another, your companies are going to be organized. The fight that we have got to wage is not only the need, and I kind of think that a million new union members over a 10-year period is pretty conservative.
Tens of millions,
yes. That's right. It's a very conservative number. And that's what we can do. The fight is not just to organize our brothers and sisters into unions so they can earn a decent middle class living, so they can have decent schedules, so they can have decent health care and decent retirement benefits. What we have got to do is support organizing all across this country. But there's something else that we have got to do as we build and revitalize the trade union movement under leaders like Sara and Sean. And that is, we have got to tell my colleagues in Congress that they got to stop listening to their billionaire campaign contributors, and they got to start listening to the needs of the working class of this country, which is struggling. What does that mean? And we have got to have an agenda. We've got to bring that agenda to every household in America. What does a progressive agenda mean? It means that health care in America must be a human right, not a privilege. And that means that we join every other major country on earth and guarantee health care to all as a human right through Medicare for all. It means that we tell the drug companies we're not going to continue paying by far the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. We're going to have Medicare negotiating prices, cut prescription drug costs by 50%. It means, and we don't talk about this enough, we're going to end starvation wages in America. There are millions of American workers right now working for $8, $9, $10 an hour. I don't know how anyone lives on those starvation wages. And we got a federal minimum wage of $7.25 an hour. We've got to raise that minimum wage to a living wage. And that means more than $15 an hour. There are millions of elderly people sitting home right now, unable to make it, live in dignity on their Social Security checks. We got to do away with that limit right now, the top gap on Medicare, on Social Security of $147,000. We got to lift that cap, tell Musk and Bezos they're going to contribute into the fund and expand benefits for all Social Security benefits. And we're going to pay for that by a tax on Wall Street speculation. And when we do that, we're also going to understand that education, the right to as much education you need without going deeply into debt, is the right of all Americans. We're going to revolutionize childcare. Families in Chicago and Vermont can't afford $15,000 a year for child care. We're going to substantially lower the cost of child care. We're going to make public colleges and universities tuition free. And we're going to end all student debt in this country. And if you can believe it, today we are the only major country on earth that does not guarantee paid family and medical leave. How barbaric is that? There are women who give birth and go back to work a week later because they need that paycheck. There are moms and dads who have to make the choice about whether they get fired from their jobs or they take care of a sick child. That is not what takes place in a civilized society. Minimum 12 weeks paid family and medical leave. Let me summarize the story of American politics in a few words. And that is, the billionaires have the money, and that money goes into their super PACs, and their super PACs elect politicians who work for them. They got the money. But you know what we got? We got the people. And building the trade union movement is not just workers earning better wages and benefits and working conditions. It means when we bring our people together in an organized, uniform way, we will have the political power to control what goes on in Washington and not the billionaire class. So, brothers and sisters, thank you very much for all that you do at the shop level and out on the streets and grassroots organizing. I believe from the bottom of my heart, and I have been like Sean all over and like Sarah all over this country and have talked at a God knows how many rallies, the American people are prepared right now to stand up, fight back, and take power. This is not easy. Real change is never easy. History of America, you know, people have fought and died in the trade union movement, in the women's movement, the civil rights movement. None of this stuff is easy, and don't kid yourself, it ain't gonna happen tomorrow. But I have zero doubt that if we stand together and not let the demagogues divide us up by the color of our skin or where we were born or what our sexual orientation might be, that if we stand together around an agenda that says that this country belongs to all of us, and not Bezos, not Musk, not the billionaire class, if we do that, there is nothing that will stop us. Thank you all very much.